Thank you, Dick. I like talking about peak oil, and since this is a peak oil conference, I'm not going to talk about peak oil. I want to talk about the rest of natural resources, because the globe's natural resources are being strained in a way that we've never seen before. And also, the price increases of these natural resources is, in many cases, in most cases, actually far greater than oil price has gone up. The first frame here, I think that the world's electrical consumption really nicely frames what's happened in global resources over the past number of years, particularly in the 21st century. In the last 18 years, we've had an increase of 8.3 terawatts in the world's consumption of electricity. 52% of that is just from three countries. And when we look at how that's broken out, we see that China is the main consumer of this. And if you look at the graph of China, you see that they had a very robust growth in the 20th century when nobody was paying attention to them. But look at what happened in the 21st century. And this is really true of almost all of the natural resources that China has been consuming. There was an explosion in the 21st century, and particularly beginning about 2003, which continued until the economic decline that we're in right now. But one of the things that's very important is we can't forget about the rest of the world, that other 48%, because they are all increasing their use of natural resources and electricity, and they all want a piece of the pie, just like the Chinese and the Indians do, and just like the Americans would like to have back. China produces a lot of their own natural resources. They're the number one producer in the world of these, number two for copper, and number three for these. So they're the number one, two, or three producer in the world of 14 of 15 important commodities. Let's look at copper, where they're the number two producer in the world. They produced all that they needed up until the end of the 20th century. And then in the 21st century, their consumption outstripped their production. And today, they are the number one importer of copper in the world. So they're the number two producer and the number one importer. And they have to import more than 40% of what they've been using. Why do we care? Well, the price shot up 457%. During the same period of time, the price of oil shot up 306%. And even with the decline that has occurred in the last year, we still have had a bounce back where copper has doubled in price since the spring. And today, if we look at the overall price increase since 2003, and all of these charts are spot prices on the London Metal Exchange since January of 2003 through about 2 weeks ago, we still have a higher price increase over that period of time than we saw the highest price increase for oil. If we look at iron ore, where they're the number one producer in the world, again, they didn't have to import a lot up until the end of the 20th century, and then they began importing at a tremendous rate, and they became the number one importer of iron ore in the world in a very short period of time. And it's because of all the steel that they're using. And the numbers are just astronomic and mind-blowing. I can quote a lot of them, but I can't really comprehend them. Opening 70,000 new supermarkets in 1 year. They became the number three car manufacturer in 2006. Actually, with the economic decline, they're now the number one car manufacturer in the world. And in 2007, they became the number two car market in the world, which is very significant for us, I think. They rolled out their 11th five-year plan that Chairman Mao started back in the late 50s. Unlike the Russians, who never met a five-year plan that they saw, the Chinese tend to meet them. And they were planning to spend a lot more money than what they'd been spending and to do a lot more building, which would use, obviously, a lot more natural resources. Even the price of scrap iron shot up tremendously. It was really amazing what was going on in Western Colorado when I was out there last year when these prices were high. People were grabbing all the old cars and everything else and shipping them off to China. This is a photograph from my hometown newspaper in Leadville, Colorado, that I think encapsulates what's happened in the minerals in the 21st century. Molybdenum exports from 2003 to 2005 doubled from the United States. Most of those went to China for use in steelmaking. And the price rose dramatically, going from about where it was at $2 a pound for a couple of decades, it hit nearly $40 a pound. And the price stayed high. One of the things that Phelps Dodge did here in Colorado was to increase, add another shift at the Henderson mine, which is the largest primary molybdenum producer in the United States, and Colorado's the largest producer of molybdenum in the United States. They also began looking at the Climax mine, which had been mothballed for a couple of decades. It's the world's largest primary molybdenum mine in the world. And they decided that if the prices stayed up for a while, that they would reopen it. And the prices, you can see, did stay up for a while. So they began tearing down the old buildings. Then Freeport bought Phelps Dodge. They relooked at it again, and they decided, yes, this is an important thing to do in our portfolio. And they continued tearing down the buildings and building a new crusher. And this is the ball mill, one of the 50-ton ball mills for the new crusher. It stopped on the main street in Leadville in front of the city hall. And you can see the high school saxophone player, part of the band that played to welcome them. The mayor welcomed it to Leadville. The county commissioner welcomed it to Leadville. The state representative welcomed it to Leadville. The mess on the street is the wine that was used to christen it. We don't waste champagne in Leadville. The banner there said... A partnership for the future, Leadville, Lake County, and Climax Molybdenum. And that's the president of Climax Molybdenum there. And he said, you know, I've been in this business for 30 years, and I've never seen anything like this, and I like it. Well, they went on up to Fremont Pass at about 11,300 feet elevation. And within 3 weeks, the price of molybdenum had crashed from over $30 a pound to under $10 a pound. And got down to $8 a pound. And tremendous crash that happened to almost all metals, except for gold and a couple of others. This was the largest crash. I mean, in 4 months, the metal prices crashed more than they did in 4 years in the Great Depression. So this was a very, very significant event worldwide. But one of the things that's important is that the price of moly has already doubled since the low of last summer. And many of the metals have started to come back. So get ready as China continues to grow and produce more and more commodities. We're going to see those prices, I think, go back up. If we look at this price deck for precious and base metal increases, we can see that the percentages are huge. In fact, for this group, the average price increase over that period of time was 379%. Remember, the price of oil was 306%. And yet I don't think very many congressmen got letters from their constituents saying, what are you going to do about the price of minerals? And if we look at another group of very important minerals, but ones that we don't really pay a lot of attention to, we see that the average price there was 746%. Again, we didn't have Congress yelling about this and trying to do something about to drive down the price of minerals. And the reason is that oil and natural gas are all sold on the spot market virtually. Contrary, coal, uranium, and all these other minerals are mostly sold on long-term fixed-price contracts. So as the spot market really is just telling you that as these contracts expire, they're going to be renewed at higher and higher prices. And that's what happened. And we saw that in all of these commodities. And what we had was this insidious inflation that was hitting us. That was a natural resource inflation. It wasn't the normal wage price spiral that we're used to seeing. And where Bernanke was worried about inflation a summer a year ago and said he was going to do something about it, kind of worried me because I don't think anybody in Washington had a clue that this was really what was driving it. And China knows what they're doing to the world's mineral resources and the energy resources, and they're going all over the world, as we well know, tying up these things. Renewable energy we're talking about going to, and that's one of the options for peak oil. Wind, you need metals to make these wind turbines. You need iron ore, and you need niobium and neodymium to go into the magnets for the turbines, and neodymium is one of the rare earth elements. Solar PVs, there are a lot of exotic metals that are used in all of these solar PV panels. That one was our one that's about 100 miles south of here that's the 16th largest PV plant in the world. This is a list of minerals, 20 of them, that are used in alternative energies of various types, from fuel cells to thermoelectric and on and on and on. We have to import over 50% of every single one of these on this list. And many of them, we have to import 100% of them. And this little group right here, the REEs, the REEs, are the rare earth elements. And China controls, depending on who you talk to, 93 to 98% of the rare earths in the world. You want to know why they wanted to buy Unocal a few years ago? You think it was for oil? Unocal owned the Mountain Pass rare earth deposit in California, one of the world-class deposits. That would have basically given them a complete lock on the world's supply. There are about 15 plus two that are kind of lumped in with these others, lanthanum and cesium. Here are four of them, neodymium, lanthanum, terbium, dysprosium. I'm sure we've all intimately familiar with all of these. But if you've got a Prius, you better be, because that's what's going into making it. This has been done classified, as one pundit, as the biggest user of rare earths of any object in the world. I read an article that Japan was having to smuggle rare earths out of China last year. And what has China done lately? Finally, we've gotten some attention about some of these minerals. China declared that they're not going to export rare earths anymore. They're saying, if you want to make a Toyota Prius, you're not going to do it in Japan or in Alabama. You're going to come to Inner Mongolia. If you want to use our rare earths, you're going to use them here to manufacture things. And that got a few people's attention, finally. London Telegraph had an article on it. All of these occurred within just 1 week. Reuters, Bloomberg News, and the previous one was in the New York Times. Cement, ordinary old cement. China was exporting cement in 2002, and they began importing it in 2003. Suddenly, we had 27 states in the United States that had a cement shortage, all the yellow ones. That's because we have to import 22% of our cement, and China tied up the ships. I mean, they take care of themselves, as they should. The next year, we had 38 states that had a shortage, and you see the green rectangle there that you're in right now didn't supposedly have one, unless you talk to anybody who had it. We finally made it the next year. The biggest producers, our three favorite countries, China consumes an awful lot of concrete, and this is one that you can ponder at night as before you go to sleep, is that 81% of our cement manufacturing is foreign-owned in this country. What does that mean when we have global shortages? Fertilizers, the Green Revolution. Last summer, there was an article, buy potash, don't buy gold, because the price is going up far faster than the price of gold is going up. Sulfur increased astronomically in just 1 year. Phosphate production in the U.S. peaked in the late 80s, and it appears that world production may have peaked in the late 90s. Nitrogen shot out of sight. I've given it to over 20,000 people here in Colorado. I had a rancher come up to me afterwards in Meeker and tell me about how he's had to change his practices because of the price increases of fertilizer. And we've got lots of food shortages worldwide. This just shows the price increases that have occurred for a number of different things. This is agriculture in green, minerals and metals in blue, and energy in red, and look at the price increases in fertilizer. And the other thing to notice is that all those others came down sharply in the economic decline, and fertilizers didn't. We can get along without cars, but we're going to have a tough time getting along without food. This is where we get our energy in the United States, in this hemisphere, and this is where we use it. The part of it that bothers me is this part, which is what we have to import, which is currently 11% of our natural gas, 2/3 of our oil, and over about 90% of our uranium. For those engineers and financial people in the audience, here are the numbers for you, percent of our energy supply here. And this is sort of my, here you can see the price increases, that oil, 306% again, 381% for the spot price of coal, 481 for uranium, and nearly 2/3 of that for natural gas. Unfortunately, the a different laptop messes up the fonts. This is what we have to import, natural gas. We're importing 16. We're now down to 10 with the flood of natural gas from shale gas. This is kind of my reality check here. 94% of our energy in the United States comes from our four conventional sources of uranium, oil, natural gas, and coal. And 6% is in our renewables category. And notice that most of that's in hydro and biomass, and we're cutting back on hydro, not increasing, except Randy's efforts down in Carbondale are hopefully going to help with this. Coal, one of the conventional mineral fuels that we have. Many people think about coal as a 19th century fuel. It's obviously a 20th century fuel and a 21st century fuel. Consumption's been increasing worldwide. China, obviously, is a big increaser of that. That's what they get all the bad press about. They don't have to import any today, but for the first time in December of 2006, they began importing. They had produced all that they needed up to that point, and then the shortfall occurred. And that was not a good day for coal prices. This is Appalachian spot price. They began importing coal back in December of 2006. The price was $38 a ton, and it hit $140 a ton. They're going to try to help this out. The Kentucky State geologist told me earlier this week that they had a delegation 2 weeks ago of Chinese who met with him and the governor, wanted to buy coal reserves in Kentucky. So we talk about the number of coal reserves that we got in the United States, but what bothers me is I think we're going to wake up someday and find out we don't own them. India likes coal, and they have to import a small amount of it. We used to like coal. We took about 90 projects off the table in 2007, and we don't import any of it. Together, China and India produce and consume over half the coal in the world. Nuclear, the world is increasing its nuclear consumption. China likes nuclear. India likes nuclear. They both want a lot more and have plans on the drawing board to build more plants. India announced in 2005 they were going to build 17 new reactors by 2012, 7 years. Can you imagine the United States saying we're going to build 17 new nuclear reactors in 7 years? Which brings us to the United States. And our last nuclear power plant was permitted in the 70s. It came online in 1996. And I usually give a quiz to these 20,000 people that I've talked to. And I can assure you that the vast majority of them, 99.9%, thought exactly the same thing that I did. That when I saw this graph, I said, that can't possibly be right, that we've increased our production of nuclear power. And I checked it in two other places. That is right. This is the best-kept secret in the United States. And everybody thinks that France is the largest generator of nuclear power. We are the largest generator of nuclear power by far, nearly double the number two country and nearly triple the number three country. And nobody knows that in this country. Why? Okay, so we've got 436 plants around the world that are now operating. We've got 44 under construction in other countries, actually one under construction in the United States. And we've got a lot of countries that see nuclear as the answer to the problem of peak oil. And they are asking for permission. The current reactors need 180 million pounds of uranium a year, but the globe is only producing 100 to 110 million pounds. And so we have this 70 to 80 million pound shortfall. And we've been making that up because in the last boom before Chernobyl and Three Mile Island, we built up this huge stockpile of yellow cake, and we've been living off of that. And we've also been converting nuclear weapons, and that's pretty much over, the conversion and the stockpile. So the markets know that we've got a shortage. The spot price that was for decades at $10 a pound shot up to about $140 a pound last summer, and then has had a sharp decline back to where it's now only five times what it was for decades, $50 a pound. Everybody thinks natural gas is going to solve our problem here in the United States. Boone Pickens wants to displace our imported oil with it. People want to displace coal plants with it. People want to prevent nuclear plants with it. People want to use it for backup for solar and wind. And I think you need to listen carefully to Art Berman and the other cautions, the caution that you heard from Matt Simmons. This scares me that we're talking about spending all of this money on infrastructure for natural gas when we haven't demonstrated that we've got the gas in this country to do this. The electrical power plants that we built in this country so far, the natural gas power plants, were not fueled with domestic gas. We didn't have enough to do it. We had to fuel them with imports from Canada. We went from a half a trillion cubic feet a year to 3.5 trillion cubic feet a year of imports from Canada, all to fuel those natural gas-fired plants, power plants. So I would urge extreme caution on this. We need to think about every silver bullet that we can get. I think we're going to need them all. I don't think natural gas will begin to do it. Conservation is obviously one that we can jump on very quickly and is probably the most important thing that we can get after to help us. We are depleting the world's natural resources, not just the oil, but we're depleting all of them. You heard about the consumption of natural gas in Asia. Everybody wants natural gas. And at the same time, the world is increasing its demand. So we're trying to run up the down escalator. And believe me, that's a hard task, having been in trying to grow oil and gas companies for a couple of decades. It's very difficult to overcome those declines each year before you can start to grow. And by the same token, as we have this increasing demand for energy, we also want to decrease our carbon footprint. And the numbers in all this are very difficult to make happen. It's not an easy task, and we need to be realistic about where we can get to, and we need to get started. So we really, I think, are in a very precarious situation right now. Here's a quote from Tom Friedman's book. And I think, unfortunately, we're not even sitting here watching the game. I think we're sitting in the stands talking to each other, ignoring the natural resource game that's going on the field out there. Thanks very much.